enjoying the design that McCann, the founder of Brothers, made in your post for today's exciting American Heritage event. Our mission is to create memorable experiences for you, our guests, and for the writers whose work we feature, whether established or not, and whether published or not, because at Brothers, we need is all about craft, and writers' ability to write and perform an engaging personal story, and to do it in 5 minutes. We are delighted to present again City Writers' beautiful flagship location here on Manhattan's west side to celebrate writers, writing, and walking, and attending American Heritage Hall with you. Italian American Heritage Month is an annual designation reserved by the Hoover, and it is the official title. This is an official title to celebrate the Italian American culture and spread the word about the traditions that come with it. Italian immigrants and Italian Americans have made so many contributions to the U.S., especially in art, humanities, and sciences, not to mention the culinary arts. And one of my favorite quotes in your program is from George Miller, who's an Australian film director best known for the Mad Max franchise, and he said, "The trouble with eating Italian food is that 5 or 6 days later, you'll be great." The title of the show comes from that TV ad campaign from the 1970s and the things that you may remember so that good that it's a title. And you will hear a few different perspectives on the title from this afternoon. We open at 1 today's show with writer Annie Casapini. And published in various literary magazines and anthologies, Annie has won many other hats, having earned her BFA in which she has performed as a voice of playwrights. She's had gigs as a prop person, a food stylist, an ESL teacher, and a voiceover artist. She also sings for time, teaches salsa, and teaches yoga and meditation. For the past 26 years, she's also been the proud mom of her talented son, Liam, who's here now, so that he's somewhere in the world's along the way, she lives with her husband, John Greger, and then Dr. Mandi, in Capitol, New York. In her story of Mandi, Anne tells of her youthful journey back to Italy. Along the way, she and her sister discovered quite unwittingly a lost key to her immigrant father's heart. And finally, welcome back to our story.
Everything essential was jammed into a well-framed orange backpacks. Traveler's packs, bureau passes, and flat pocket instamatic camera. It was 1978, and Sister Marie and I were about to embark on a 2-month tour of Europe. I was 20, she was 25. We would begin in Italy, where our father, Giovanni Battista Casapini, was from. John had immigrated to the U.S. in 1925, but he never came back. His two sisters stayed there. They had faithfully exchanged letters for over 50 years. They never thought to use a telephone. International calls were a big deal then, and expensive. I and my sister were alive and very Italian, but his dad had never spoken to us. Generation didn't pass on their language. They wanted their children to speak English. So, I shared our itinerary with our aunts, written on airmail stationery, a mix of Italian and dialect in Rome. We would do our best to guide ambassadors. After a few days in Venice, we got on a train that would take us 80 miles to the northern countryside to visit the place our dad was born. The historical capital of Filippo. As it got closer and the train slowed, all we could see was a cement pitch and lots of tubes. No official station, no platform, no sign. Holding a scrap of paper, we asked the people on the train in a guidebook Italian, "Please, where is this address?" They shouted out to us, "Qui, here!" as they pointed out the windows. We were the only passengers getting off. Climbed down the embankment and walked into the woods, following a narrow footpath, hoping to find the town. Soon, we saw a woman in a skirt and headscarf. We approached her for directions. "Buongiorno, scusi, signora, what way?" you looking at us closely?
Oh, really? Oh, so beautiful to see you.
We were cousins. Over the following 5 days, our aunts, Zia Anna and Zia Regie, were so happy to have us. We all did with each other as to who would host us for lunches and dinners. We got to meet our cousins and see the church and the dear old ladies baptized. We tasted potato pie made with a renowned, delicate, nutty flavored cheese and pastio. And this is kind of a little bit. One afternoon, they took us to see a small ship. Our father had helped his dad to build, but had miraculously survived an earthquake. The earthquake had knocked down the original family home. The shed had a wheelbarrow and tools and beautiful wooden handles. Zia Anna told us Dad and his father could use them every day. He felt like a countless, uncovering rare artifacts from here on his past and connections to the early history. The capture day was bittersweet. Although we were excited to see more of you, we were sad to leave our newfound loving family. Our aunts were older in the late 70s. When, if ever, would we return? What must Dad have felt at age 18 when he had to leave all he knew and loved to go to America to climb and earn money? Our relatives walked us to the train. They lifted their hands to wave goodbye and wish good luck, and what we had learned is the pretty long tradition. Instead of the American farewell, with palms facing out, their palms faced in, as if to beckon us to change our minds and stay. The phrase they used was Mandi. Back in the U.S., we sat down to share stories with Dad. When he saw the photos of the shed and the tools, he went quiet and said simply, "Yes, when I was a boy, I carved those handles with the pump." Then my sister and I raised our hands, turned our palms in, and shared the three-line Mandi. Dad's eyes widened, glistening with held-back tears as he looked up at a gesture he had not seen in decades. Nodding his head in the room with a pitiful distress, he leaned his torso forward, elbows on his knees, and stared at his hands. I knew if I had ever gone back, I would not have been able to leave my home a second time.
David Masello moved to New York City from Edelson, Illinois, and he has made his living as a writer and reporter for more than 35 years, which is motorcycles. His career began as a nonfiction book editor at Simon & Schuster, and he went on to hold senior editorial positions at many magazines, which I couldn't help but notice. Happened to have a lot of magazines and editorials, including Travel and Leisure, Art and Antiques, Big Town and Country. He's a widely published essayist, poet, and playwright. His work appears in the New York Times, Best American Essays, numerous literary and art magazines, and small theater companies. He's currently executive editor of New York Magazine about design and architecture. You know, he's written 3 books about art and architecture. He still wonders when he will write that book, and it's meant to write. And the story he shares with us today, my friend, Lovidico. David introduces us to one of his most cherished friends and confidants in New York, one whose empathy and understanding takes him to new heights. Please help me welcome David Masello. Years ago, upon breaking up with someone, I became embarrassing for the garden at Central Park. I went to see Lovidico. I needed his approval and reassurance. He was also one of the first people I visited years after September 11th. Whenever friends are in from out of town, I take them to meet him. And if I find myself in this ugly, sad neighborhood, I can rarely resist walking by. Lovidico lives in a footpath, mansion is here. He has a portrait painted in the 1550s by Gragnano. Florentine artist employed as a court painter to the Medici. In this 4 foot high oil, Lovidico is shown with wavy red brown hair, flawless complexion, and long gray breast. I have known Lovidico for many years as I've lived in New York. After these 4 decades, I keep asking the same question: how do I continue to visit this mute, overdressed, and curious young man? People to whom I introduce him find him austere and curious. When I was close to Lodovico's age, about 22, many people said I resembled him. My right eye wanders lazily in the way his left does, his nose appears to grow out of the time. I suppose it's natural we are attracted to those who remind us of ourselves. Once after I sent a postcard of the portrait to my father in Florida, he called to say that he took Lodovico to his refrigerator. "He looks like you, only without your eyeglasses," my father said. "And get a haircut, you can be as clean cut as this kid." Much has changed since we met. I am now nearly 3 times as old as he is in the painting. I've had careers, multiple apartments, been involved with partners over the years. Yet, I need the unspoken advice to go to the first apartments. He wears a high collar, velvet striped taffeta jacket with a white satin skirt, sleeves embellished with fish-eye patterns. A swag of black gold that swoops from his right shoulder to his billowy reaches and down to his shoulder tucked piece. In one hand, he pinches a cameo with the mysterious inscription "Sort Death," fate or fortune. Despite his calm demeanor, Lodovico was living in trying times for painting. As a court page, he fell in love with Madalena Vittori, who, his employer, Cosimo de' Medici, he chose as a bride for one of his cousins. Upon her end of the portrait, the duke forbade the couple to meet. His wife empathized with the couple and intervened on their behalf. After 3 years, the duke acquiesced, but stipulated that unless the couple married within 24 hours, they'd be forever separated. Lodovico and I have maintained an odd relationship. We don't speak, but I can look at him into something. And I miss him quickly as weeks go by without a visit. He neither smiles nor frowns, seems judging or indifferent, appears happy or sad. Lodovico is my Dorian Gray. Because he'll never age or fade, neither will my memories of my life in New York in my early 20s, and Lodovico was one of the first figures I met and came to know as a friend. If he could see me, he would have observed over the years a picture of me before him, along with various mates as they entered and left my life, or with friends, several of whom died in the 1980s during the war of the plague. He'd have seen me wearing ties wide as napkins, player ones neuter, narrow, glasses and styles from Brandy to Caviglia. As he aged, Lodovico became aware of this. As an adult, he had that same portrait painted on his Proxy ceiling, so that upon awakening, he'd see the young version of himself staring down, mirror-like. I know that if Lodovico came to life, we would eagerly teach each other the ways of our time. We wouldn't know how to negotiate intrigues, renaissance, courts, and court life, and he wouldn't understand the complete custom. But I'm sure our friendship would be an easy one. We would be, as they say in Italian, sincere. Minnette Coleman, a member of the Harlem Writers Guild, grew up in Atlanta, Georgia, where she wrote entertainment theaters for the Atlanta Theatre Group when she was a teenager. While majoring in drama at Wesley College in Greensboro, North Carolina, she appeared in several productions but was a frequent contributor to the college newspaper. She's the author of three historical novels, she's the college relates to the simple fruit, or is it a vegetable, was nothing less than transformative and more than just a complex today. I'm glad to have you with us here today. Please welcome Minnette Coleman.
We were conjugating verbs until my sister had been a professor complained. Americans know nothing about food. I was amazed at the habit. We called her that because she was 4'10" and wore a size matching suit. Went on a rant. Senora was insulted by the cafeteria's attempt to watch. The pomodoro was bruised, she shouted, because if this was culinary tips and meant Italian 101. Bruised, I said, I that bad tomato. It's an insult to Italian cuisine. Italians no food. Italians no tomatoes. But here, you can do it with ketchup and call it dinner. Well, my mother made a brown up with ketchup the other side. But this is a lot of Italian food, especially tomatoes. My dad had indigestive cancer, so one didn't die. Salads were usually lettuce and cucumbers. I removed tomatoes from my school lunch tray, and I had no fealty to spaghetti or pizza. A date once served fried green tomatoes, a southern delicacy I avoided. He might not swallow small bits of the juicy grainy tree. And to offset the taste down to fruit glass and wine. A delightful rare called Boone's Farm.
I'm really not sure which was worse.
Years later, art, not food, was on my mind when my husband and I had visited Italy. Couldn't wait to get to any food citizen, back to Chinese Bank of Venice, and the Academy of Gallery to see Michelangelo's David, then sit. The universe of a local cafe. Fortunately, I had graduated from top one. When we arrived in Florence, our room wasn't ready, so we were treated to prosecco in the hotel bar, served with bread, fresh bread, olive oil, delicious olive oil, tomato dipping sauce. My husband noticed a scar on my face. The one kids give when certain food they hate. Try it, he suggested. I don't do tomatoes. He pushed the type of sauce plate closer to me. Try these tomatoes. You know, when in Rome, we're in Florence, I know. We're in Italy, and tomatoes are everywhere. Mind you, that was one of the few Italian words. The waiter looked at me, looking at the tomatoes. Tomato chicken, please. I had everything as high as I expected. He lingered until I dipped the bread into the real sauce for a keen taste. Then it blew my mind and changed. Never had I ever tasted anything so sensual in my life. I drew tomato juice. I dip the bread again and again, thinking that Italians eat no food, especially tomatoes. From that moment on, I reveled in pomodoro heaven. On an all-you-could-eat buffet in Rome, my salad was just tomatoes fresh from the vine. I wanted every green tomato that Italy had. Fresh San Marzano's on pizza. We shipped him with good aromas. Tomato sauce, so clean you could sip it. When I left Italy, I wanted to take a suitcase full of pomodoro with me. Yeah, nothing like this back home. On the last day, we ordered insalata di mare from a cozy restaurant near the hotel in Italy. When the dish arrived, packed with scallops and mussels, the calamari, I looked at it. No tomatoes. My husband said, this is seafood salad. Why would it need tomatoes? Because it's Italian, I quit. Not everything needs tomatoes to eat it. The idea? To later set the criminal captive. Soon I would be back in the States and missing the luscious fine western fruit and missing vegetables that came from this or that valley. Taste of fresh tomatoes would be lost forever unless somewhere in Jersey they were growing polar bears that tasted like the last and more.
Her Substack newsletter offers her unique insights on clothing and life, not necessarily on boredom, and she's been published in the Libretto. In her story, Filippo is coming up here, and it relates the concept to new types of old character. And now, the first time he's on the Welcome to the Stage.
Reduces us to stupid conversations about mozzarella deliveries. It's hard to work with people who can make a gathered base. Filippo is shy and tough. And Chancellor, the eldest, is the funniest. When he tells stories, they lean in, smile expectantly as he pauses before a punchline, then throw their heads back to him. Angela has the shortest tweet. When a customer takes too long or has an attitude, his jaw tenses and he taps his fingers on the counter, muttering in a way that makes the others step in. Angela doesn't speak much English, but he loves the word "asshole." Night shifts fly. Sunday afternoons are different. We amble in and take our places at the counter. We slowly open cans of peppers and stick tabs into slots, turning sheets of cardboard into the boxes that scribble orders into the river. The air is scented with rosemary and garlic, onions and lemons, lighter and fresher than the essence of mozzarella and tomato that constantly clings to me. On Sundays, the men cook, not for customers, but for us. Here, and Angelo's chicken roasted with lemons and onions. The place feels different when they cook. Slower, sweeter, quieter. Filippo loves lay-down salad by Eric Clapton, but apparently thinks Sally is an elderly Jewish man who needs a knife. sing along to write down the song. And sip on wine until the phone rings. Penny rose and got the word saying, I scribbled the order and returned to the table. Pizza can wait. It's Sunday. And we're doing it. Remember that time when I was in the middle of the holidays,
When she turned 60, Gloria quickly decided it was time for more than just cake and tables. She began writing a memoir. The goal was to memorialize how to make a crazy Italian family, with many recipes that fell from body and soul as she was growing up. The result is her book, The Pork Chop in the Window, from her first place. When she's not writing, Gloria enjoys walking her back in the many gorgeous trails and lakes of the world, as a junior, Gloria described it as finding out the family that was born of her son in the clan and gathered to send her home with their dear to tell him. He said that old boy would come with you.
Everyone knows it's a big blessing up for him. I mean, who doesn't take a bit of a gold jewel and throw it across the past of the moon? When we heard that my mother's older sister, Maria, known as Biff, had died, we took down to Jerusalem for the three-day paying respects and thoughts. My children were too young to be left alone, so I had to take them with me, giving them strict orders to be seen and not heard, or seen in the funeral parlor. When we arrived, I sat both my son and daughter in chairs and saw them walk, hoping that they wouldn't make a fuss, and that my mom and I could watch the parade of mourners in the front. Anne Marie, Aunt Marie's granddaughter, was decked out in a customary black, but her arms were adorned in so much gold with various gems as to look like Nefertiti on a Nat Geo documentary. She was sporting a diamond ring on her right hand that looked like it needed to be carried in a wheelbarrow, and gold loops that had trilocite diamonds all the way around them. Believe me, I was taking notes for the recap discussion with Mom on the way home. Next in line was Aunt Annie. Black was her go-to color, so it was no surprise that she was wearing her pantsuit. However, as a senior member of the family, she had to pay homage properly with 5-inch circumference gold earrings and a mammoth black onyx ring so heavy she could hardly lift her hand to wave them off. Behind Aunt Annie was my cousin Junie. Junie was wearing a black suit with a white shirt and a black tie. Around his neck hung 3 gold chains, one of which had a medal of the Sacred Heart of Jesus, whose head was encased in diamonds. As my eyes continued downward, he had on diamond and gold cufflinks, a 2-carat diamond ring on one pinky, and a sapphire and diamond ring on the other pinky. When I got to his shoes, I couldn't believe my eyes. White patent leather with gold buckles. Snazzy. Julie never took the no-watch shoes after Labor Day seriously. I nodded to each mourner as they passed in front of the casket, taking mental notes of who was wearing what jewelry and how costly it was. Of course, Sandy came in wearing only one piece, a honker of a diamond ring that was 3 carats of pear-shaped perfection, set in plain. A ring that truly belonged in the Smithsonian. She didn't need anything else. That ring screamed impressive. Uncle Joe passed by as well, sporting a watch that was almost as big as he was, with diamonds around the crystal. Uncle Joe was an electrician, and he enjoyed wearing his watch on special occasions. Nothing says special like a funeral in New Jersey. Several of the second cousins came by to pay their respects, many of the younger ones wearing silver bangle bracelets and costume necklaces of matching earrings. The memo hadn't reached their generation, and if it had, they weren't investing in it. Such a pity. After a while, I glanced over to see how my children were faring. They didn't seem bored and they weren't fidgety, so I thought that we could remain a little while longer. Finally, the gold parade was waning, and so I gathered up the kids and my mother and said goodbye to all. The kids were silent on the way home. I attributed it to them having to sit for several hours in a funeral parlor. During dinner that evening, my husband asked how the day went. My son piped up, "Dad, you'll never believe it! Mom's family's in the mafia!"
there was this guy wearing two pinky rings and gold chains and white shoes. Now that's Italian.
It's an uncomfortable organization with a mission to create memorable experiences for the writers and guests for things like this. And at the time, especially this week, so much writers can feel so much of it and so uncertain. We've got their minds as to shift stories and publish them. While I can feel it can be a gift for something that nourishes the stories. And part of what we're building are all of our team that's working to scale up to attract more writers, more followers, more listeners, and to establish another home. Of course, for the tickets you purchased for today's show, does feel free to ask from City Winery, but I'll come back from the case to you. Things like burgers, things that help you set some of our basic operating costs. So if you're enjoying today's show, you can help us grow. Your donations are invested in our mission. If you have tickets to the next level, so please consider tax deductible gifts that are in the middle of the rest of the day. Scanning the code on the back of your program will take you to the donation feature on the website, but I'll post it to the website. So I spoke to our friend Sally, who runs Scrapbook Square. She calls Staples Union Square. She printed new exclusive QR codes. And Richard, before you got here, stood in the lobby with scissors, tasting these things out by herself. So, you know, being executive producer encompasses all kinds of tasks that you might never have imagined, but I do hope that all that you think reaches, you know, touches one of you or more of you. Because there's still that code, which will take you directly to the donate page on our website. Sign it up against the credit card. And the other thing that you can do is to don't leave that code in your phone. Take it with you. Share it with another writer in your life. You must know one. And we're finding that word of mouth. Time someone would have told me that I'm going to write it about this. It was helping us grow. We have in this show today, we have seven new writers who might have never met before today. And I'm so delighted that they are here. And I love that this community is growing. And this room is full. The energy I know, this is so beautiful. I'm so grateful to the writers and for all of you supporting me in the writing. So I thank you for your encouragement. We're going to pause here for a short break of 15 minutes, during which friends here in the service and teams and quarters can refill your glasses. And when you hear this bell, you're going to hear someone like this. You can come to your seats for the second half of our show, and more great stories. And by the way, I will tell you that my sister is here. This is, I don't have very many relics in my childhood. This is the bell that somebody remembers. This is the bell that my mom remembers at 6. And this is the bell that my mother used to call us for. And, you know, she'd ring it out like that. If she had to call you the third time, it was not going to be good. So, anyway, so I'm only going to call you once this time. I enjoy having your bells of seats for the second time. I'm sure you have more stories to share. And then McCann, and this is my first speech. Thank you very much. Welcome back to the second half of today's special event celebrating its 10th Heritage Month. Before we bring up the next writer, I want to remind you we are always working to feature new and diverse voices, ever accepting submissions from upcoming shows. You'll find more information about that in your program and more details on our website, writersmag.org. Again, please take the program with you and share with one writer from Coleman or Caviglia. And please know that if you have questions or suggestions, you can please email me. Thank you to all the people who have made this thing possible. From the folks here at Coleman, including I am seeing what is very grateful to my partner and writer to be able to take with me from Richard Coleman from the Olympics. And to our editors, David Masello, who is a company manager from Radio Zangla, and to our production manager, Chief Technology Officer, and to our Filippo Center. Thanks to you, Mark, and all the tips that have been provided by Florence. It's a special day because we have given up to the United Nations. Kevin was a really talented. One of the wonderful things about this, and we're almost 10 years old, is there is really a sense of community and family that has kind of grown up around us for the future. And anyway, it's really been such a pleasure and such a privilege to be involved in something like this, and with the support of people who care about what we're doing, and with the potential that we're supporting this thing, and with the community, and with the spoken word, and the second word, and the other word, and the Julianne and Forlamo, who gets up to Juliana is a professor in the media and department at Manchester University. She also hosts her own show for the Lovidico Business Network. And her work has been featured in a few books, including Letters to President Obama and Letters to the American Voter. On the lighter side, Juliana is also a stand-up comedian, which has performed all over the country, including here in New York City, at the Great Carolines, and at the Apollo Theater. In her story, taking back to Rome, or to Rome, Juliana digs deep in every one of these departments to find those relationships that are left, and reclaims a history that's been nurtured and sustained for the first time on our stage. Please help me welcome Gragnano.
I am the granddaughter of a woman who, when she immigrated to the United States from her remote mountain village in southern Italy, smuggled dried beans across the Atlantic, reportedly in her mubas. AKA underwear. She left behind jewelry from her mother, but brought along a couple of beads. Generations of my family have been eating the homegrown descendants of her illicit contraband every summer since 1963. My father used to hide the fact that he grew up in Calabria. The people of this southernmost region of the Italian boot have long been maligned with negative stereotypes. Capodost, stubborn. Testadura, hard-headed, dumb. And worse, Terrone, peasant, dirty, of the land, knowing nothing but how to work land, uncultured. Although for a time, my father cultivated a tremendous, abundant vegetable garden in our suburban, upstate New York backyard, he did not want to be known in America as a Terrone, and he hid his affinity and his aptitude. Unfortunately, disavowing his roots left him with an emptiness that somehow got passed down to me as an American-born daughter. I inherited a painful longing for a motherland I had never seen and a way of life I had never really known. When, as an adult, I moved to Connecticut, I signed up for the condo's community garden, hoping to continue the family legume tradition. There had been this moment among the bean poles in my aunt's garden the year before. Right there, in the middle of the mature plants, towering over me, the leaves gently rustling in the late summer breeze. The essence of my father, my nonno, and what seemed like unnamed generations of ancestral energy just came alive in the stalks. It moved right through me, and for a brief moment, I did not feel the familiar longing, but instead, wholeness and connection. I wanted to continue to feel that. So, going against my father's original directive, I cut out my chabra. The first thing I learned in my foray into gardening is that it is quite arduous to prepare a freshly built garden plot, especially when the nearby towns, no doubt named after soil type, are called Stonyfield Terrace and Rockland Park. The plot is full of rocks to dig the holes for the celery, the tomatoes, the peppers, the zucchini, and of course, the sacred beets. I hacked hard at that stony ground as I labored, a word broke into consciousness. Stop. Then again, stop, stop, stop. With each strike of the hardened land, I didn't even know I had that word buried under the rocky soil of my consciousness. But it sprang up into mind each time I hit the ground. I hadn't heard the word used in decades. Talk about a metaphor. It was both loosening the soil of a garden and loosening the soil of my soul, letting that inner authentic calabasella come up and out. Along with the word came a warm memory of my neighbor who used it often when discussing his American Jardino. And just like that, another layer of that old familiar longing just drifted away. As I continued my efforts at Zapote, I encountered rocks and stones of all dimensions, and I piled them to the side. The tile grew into a mound and a road. And a wall. Well, looky here, I thought. I have unwittingly built a garden retaining wall, just like my nonno built for his pomodoro beds, and scores of nonnos before him built all along the Italian countryside. And what's more, I had enjoyed doing it. I began to feel connected, not just to my roots, but to the random little rocky piece of Connecticut. Because I had worked it, the land was no longer foreign to me, and I was no longer foreign to myself. I dropped the bony beans into the earth and rejoiced in having become a proud and joyful peasant.
This story is about a dusty story adventure that illustrates the tears that cost too much to take care of the moment, especially for this world's particular context and the next day. Every great energy is held to the I talked with my hands and made my own sauce and sandwich that was for my dog in the backyard. But no, I'm originally Hungarian, not culturally so in many cases, but those are the main components of the European markets. My wife is Italian. She's the one who told me how to make that sauce. The first time I did, don't even joke to buy a pie. Here was a tea and a taste. She stood quietly, stunned, I think, for a second. Fast, good.
told me to shut up, she walked away with a piece of bread soaked with her Jewish husband's good bread sauce. While that may all be true, I'm not Italian. Instead, I like to think of myself as Italian, but that's it. I remember going to Thanksgiving dinner for the first time with my wife's baby before we left. She explained to me before you, it's a lot of food. Yes, I get it, I said, but it's getting hard for you. She shook her head, understanding that I was conducting school. She was right. I did not understand. We sat on four separate tables. First for antipas, both cured meat, salami, bologna, stromboli, salad greens, stuffed hot peppers, artichoke hearts, and fresh oregano. Next for macaroni, which at the time were handmade by Grandma Mary, bajol, meatballs, and sausage. And then for turkey, 28-pound bird, Italian stuffing, that's good sausage. Cranberry sauce, homemade, of course. Sweet potato casserole, and broccoli rabe. Or, to my father, a little bit more, coconut. Gentle red wine on the white linen tablecloth. My father washed me right in the way. He told me as he poured more vino into my glass, don't worry, my dear wife wouldn't be able to leave. When we returned to the table for the fourth and final time, dessert was served, thankfully, light. Coffee, cannoli, it's called Gragnano, more commonly known as Italian wedding cookies. As all of the food and drink being passed around, so much of which was unfamiliar to me, my mother would have asked, Mother, I want to try some lemon jello. In my ignorance, I said, Mother, no thanks, I don't really like jello. She smiled and showed me the bottom of the soap before, and gently corrected me. Mother, don't you try it? It's a drink. I laughed my embarrassment away as she poured me some, and served me thinking, it's just got to happen. Later, when my wife and I were in the car ride home, I couldn't stop talking about the feast. I gave the traditional turkey dinner from my growing up in Tokyo, and asked my wife for pronunciations and clarifications and ingredients all while we sat in traffic, close friends back to the island. Somewhere, probably around, that's what I heard. I asked, learning a new word. Oh, yes. And what the hell is beyond the lean? My wife yelled and laughed, told me it was peach. Every time I do the work here, trying to get various stains out of my kids' wipes, grab the car off and sit myself beyond the lean. So, no, I'm Italian. Irish and Hungarian, which certainly have their charms. But sometimes, even with family or sitting with the glass of wine, I see myself as a good one. To be a child. Lynn Edelson has been writing that work for 15 years. Lynn and Edelson is the creator of the New York City.
Thank you.
you can make directly from the tree. Olives, fruits, eggs, and cakes you get from the tree. Sitting in that dining room, opened upward to the porch, overlooking the tomatoes, was enchanted. So what do you like to cook, Aston? I could see her sensing it. Result, she said. Everybody thinks it's such a big deal, but it's not. You throw it into a pressure cooker, put in some strawberries, and let it cook. Strawberries, I said. She smiled. That's my secret, she said, enjoying my cooking techniques. And from that moment on, we liked it. We visited a man 2 years later, but my husband was running a fever. Yes, she said, obviously not remembering us at all. Welcome back. Later that evening, she offered us a meal of tea. Drink this, she said to my husband. With Filippo. You know, last time we were here, I said, you told me to put strawberries into the risotto in the pressure cooker. Which one should I buy? She put her fingers on the neck. I closed the cassette door. I told you that, she said. I nodded my head. She got down on her knees in front of a cabinet and began pulling out plates. Finally, she found the pressure cooker hidden all the way in the back. She looked around again to make sure. This one is the best, she said, pointing to the Lagostino in Finland. I'm telling you, whenever everyone thinks I cook on the big stove and store the risotto until it's done, she said, who has time for that? 5 minutes in the pressure cooker, you start, and 15 minutes later, it's done. You're unbelievable. Do you think we're looking for all this food and flowers? You don't? Of course not, she said. And in the winter, when my friends and family come to visit, we dance and smoke cigarettes. This place is just so beautiful, I said. But the fantasy is just so blessed. You know, I never let people into my kitchen. Except for when they first get here, she said, it's not enough. And it's a perfect kitchen, I said. Well, you think so, she said? Look at this. She took down one of these huge antique pans off the wall and placed it on the table. It was Teflon Porter, she said. You slime cup, I said, laughing. She was cracking. It's all the and I'm sitting on a discharge so I don't fry my skin melting in my tongue, yellow polyester soap fabric designed to block any hair from reaching my body. My parents, Brother Walt, and I are going to embark on a final pilgrimage to the Mecca of Macaroni and Sinhurst, Brooklyn. We are going to see our Uncle Santi and Margaret Menendez. They are not real relatives. We are not Italian. They were neighbors before our family immigrated from Hartsville, Brooklyn to Queens. And for reasons I don't understand, when Dad drives onto the hair-raising picket fence and first went to cross over the border into Brooklyn, our mother will call out from her command center in the backseat and insist we close the windows of our unhair-conditioned car so that her beautiful hairpin doesn't budge and some stray firecracker doesn't fly into our car. While my brother serves as Dad, my mother will issue traffic and driving commentaries the entire trip as she clutches her homemade sour cream cheesecake in her lap. I'm crouched in the back, silently crying. My prayers increase in their intensity as we hear the pizza shop. Regal, intense, Milanese, the woman is waiting for us on the sidewalk. Uncle Santi, a joyful Neapolitan. It means we are doomed. Tonight, in their apartment, while they have many beautiful things in their apartment, the one thing that they don't do is it. The place is decorated elegantly with oriental carpets and carved wooden sofas, upholstered in velvet, and covered in plastic. I will be spending the afternoon trying to peel my legs off to the couch without grimacing or making sticking sounds as I try not courses, my brother will play his accordion, which he's brought up the stairs and from way down the street. I'll tap dance and dance ballet and a pirouette with to mention anything. If only Uncle Santi grants us things will. It means that everyone will be eating in the shops that morning under the great sun. Uncle Santi will fuss up with my brother. He will introduce him to the staff and show him all the estimated gadgets he's designed. Aunt Margaret and mother will chit-chat. Next, Uncle Santi will take me on a private tour of the shops of
tour with the flowers. Homemade raviolis and meatballs and gravy to put the crust
teaches memoir writing and volunteers at the Christopher College of Law School for their next month. And makes me wonder what this journey in Cox County has been like. Her work has been published in Toasted Cheese, the campus of other literary magazines, as well as several publications. A postcard prize nominee, that is the author of the memoir,
in Bolivia, a mild October afternoon, I asked the 6 years man behind the counter for a coffee.
Americano, Decaffeinato, per favore.
I say it loud because it's Italian. And I love to hear myself speak it. To say the words Signora taught me in class so many years ago. These actual words. I did them into the window. But all Italian words remind me of home, reading me with a cheerful ciao. I love to practice different languages, and I never miss a chance, though I sometimes confuse people. My friends and I are visiting Tuscany, and I've been sick. But today, my body feels rested and light. The sun is warm and bright, and I'm with a good friend. Decaf, my usual, sounds like washing, like scratching. But here in the land of alcohol, it becomes a drink for having. Everything we say here, everything we hear is music. Every ancient, round-bodied word is a melody to everyone to sing.
Piccolo, the country asks. Espresso!
No piccolo, I say, waving my finger from side to side. Too small. I don't expect an American-style mug.
me, my doctor said, while recovering from COVID, and even on the best of days, caffeine gives me hope, anxious, and upsets my stomach. But I do love the smell and the taste, and the little buzz. Mi dispiace, non parlo italiano bene. Like the tenor in the opera. I don't speak English well, it seems. I see the skin cut. The warm, dark smell reaches my nose so good, so familiar, even without the buzz. My companion speaks to this man, who is now her friend. Just coffee, regular coffee, he says. And he seems to her, too. Caffè normale. We all three laugh and share the joke. Is it a joke? Across the counter. Across the sea of our separate coffee-linked lives. I see us on stage at the Met. He wears a white apron and sings to me, 2 euros. My fingers do a little fumbling dance inside my coin purse. I sigh an impatient, embarrassed sigh. My hand passes 2 gold coins into his. Grazie, his deep voice sings. He glides away from me across the stage to serve my friend. I sidestep to the tip jar. Place my hand over the open top and release 2 small coins that ring like tiny bells against the glass. Ciao, my alto floats toward him. With a little wave, I exit stage left and settle onto a blue metal chair outside. My friend takes a seat opposite me, and our hands close around our warm cups on the sky blue table. I sip the familiar beer. It warms my lips, my throat, my belly. The fear, the worry, the sickness of the past week dissolves in the warm vitality of sun. The curtain rises in cafe in hand. My soul. It was a house in my Jersey Shore neighborhood, 7,000 years ago. It's a war that had nothing to do with the interstellar cars from the top floor. Some of the cars and hammerbacks were in the ground, or even what I imagined that door to look like. A sandbox, a sunset, a purified color and color candy. I didn't care deeply about these things. But I did dream about them, as I rode my bicycle along the sidewalk in front of this curious spot. It was the wildflowers in the
purple, yellow, green, and pink. They are delicate, warm. The answer to summer gazes was a graceful color, a whispering bend. The red geraniums as a beautiful plant in the backyard were thick, slender. When the summer wind blew, they moved too, but not with grace. They were just trying to survive. If it was a hard wind, they bent into water, close fell, staining and searing the concrete blue. I've written about the red geraniums before, mostly out of anger. I was angry at my parents for making me paint plate cakes for those pinky red flowers, and for making me carry water in old empty Paisano bottles to those cakes when the greens didn't come, and for making me pinch their toes off when they looked old and dry. I was angry at my parents for driving non-bunkers to get Cadillacs and making Continentals and for serving sausage sandwiches with long green Italian fine peppers and barbecue for barbecues. I was angry at my parents because of how those flowers affected the life I wanted at the time. I may have strutted around my neighborhood in a black t-shirt with glittery traced of underlying letters that read, Italian Princess, across the front. But truthfully, I was confused. I loved my sugar, but I also craved hippie cars, wooden fences, and American barbecues. During a visit to Calabria a few months ago, fiery and fragmented memories marked the American home resurfaced. This was the region where both of my grandfathers were born and raised. My bones rattled. All at once, the tomato and red onion salad, various uses for starts of pasta water, the sacredness of black licorice, and the smell of fennel, and new and wise characters, and a story of what the story had completed. The red geraniums were everywhere, popping up from earth and planters, from window boxes next to clotheslines, and from vases facing tombstones. On the Colombian soil and salt, and there are many other familiar things, the Julianne, the Journey, and the new part of my story this morning. Who do you think you are? My father asked me. For many years, there was fury in his voice. The tone was, how dare you want more, want to say, how dare you want to explore, to think. This inquiry, this soft of these days, and almost 20 years ago. It's more like a whisper, and comes from a place I still don't understand, yet I want to know. Who do I think I am? I might say that to someone, answering a question with a question. And then yet, I can most say that to my parents. Today, the geraniums I see are bolder and bigger in size, in color, and spirit. I never knew they could be. I see their beauty now, how they sway with power and stamina, how the petals come back with ferocity, soon after the dry leaves disappear. When I was young and confused, I missed seeing their grace, their beauty, their collaborative strength. But life loss, the physical pain, and faith changed them. In fact, those bursts of Colombian red blooms make the world. Welcome back to the stage.
office room where I had worked part-time. I worked many times, but to start my senior year, I quit my part-time job. I took a cash to the library. I was paid $3 an hour, plus whatever tips I had, and continued to ask. The restaurant was owned by the soon learned that purchasing these extra things on request and route to a pizza delivery to the TV jobs too. Secondo sized box, those two regular cans at Tendo, creating the thought in the second time that the world will take 20% to see the others for 20 minutes. Tips for this group of fine writers are part of what a very simple group of committed, fun, committed volunteer or committee members or board members to take a secret place, especially in the areas of more pending convenience. You're going to make the choice. You're going to make the So, if you have any ideas or suggestions here, or any interests, please take a good perception on your public speech with the comments and suggestions you can find. None of us wants more email, but if I hope you will allow us to stay in touch by joining our podcast, I will only send out a newsletter once, maybe twice a month, but that newsletter will share with you information on suspicions of live events. And you can, at the bottom of any page on our website, you can sign up for that. You can see what message there you're going to put up, so you can also share with one click. Please fill out your calendars to join us again in this room. We will be back on Sunday, January 14th as well. To that's when we present our next show in the 10th. You have until November 4th for the writers and fans. You have until November 4th to share your story on hair cuts, hair loss, hair color, shade, waves, seaming, mohawks, cornrows, dreads, barbers, salons, wigs, anything all about hair, hairlessness. So please get cracked until November 1st. Please say it's friends of ours. Please consider that. I mentioned earlier, we can only do what we do. We just want to get this kind of a close to the stage. Please don't rush on for the wine that is still wanting to drink. If you enjoyed today's show, please